Good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the lecture of Real Analysis 1. Let us have a look at the concepts we have studied in the last lecture. In the last lecture, we have completed an important theorem called as Bonnet's theorem, where this Bonnet theorem is derived by using the Abel's lemma. We have repeated the statement of Abel's lemma in the last lecture. Let us have a look to this Bonnet's theorem. What the statement says that? Statement is very simple. It says that integration phi, integration g both exist. Exist means what? What this word exist tells us? Yes, anyone from the student?
The functions are continuous and bounded.
Not continuous, it is bounded. Bounded and integrable. Correct? Because we have seen that the functions which are not continuous are also integrable. Some 2-3 results we have seen accordingly. Therefore, here, whenever we say that integration exists, it simply means that the given functions are bounded, given integrands are bounded and they are integrable. Second statement is phi is positive monotone decreasing. This function phi is positive monotone decreasing on the closed interval AB. Then we have proved that there exists a point zeta such that A to B, integration A to B phi g dx is equals to phi of A times integration A to zeta g dx. Phi of A integration A to zeta g dx. Right? And to prove this, what we have done? We have started with a partition, assuming small m I and capital M I be the bounds of g in the ith subinterval. We have written this. Then with some suitable algebraic steps, we have completed the proof of Bonnet's theorem. I'm not going to repeat the steps again. If you have any kind of difficulty regarding the proof, you can ask me. We will just cover your doubts and we can go from there. No? Okay, let me go for last theorem of this first unit called as second mean value theorem. We have already discussed the proof was given by Karl-Weierstrass and the proof depends on Abel's lemma and Bonnet's theorem. Actually, Bonnet's theorem depends on Abel's lemma. And the proof of second mean value theorem depends on Bonnet's theorem. Okay, now let me write second mean value theorem. The statement is what is first mean value theorem? Can anyone recall? Yes, what is first mean value theorem?
If function is continuous in closed interval AB, then there exists a number zeta in that interval, closed interval AB, such that integration A to B fx dx equal to f of zeta B minus A.
Good, very good. This is the first mean value theorem. There exists a mean value called as zeta, where zeta is the number such that we are getting integration A to B f of x dx is equal to f of zeta into B minus A. And this for this mean value to exist, we want a condition on the function is function should be continuous on the given interval. Now we will have a look to the second mean value theorem. The statement says that if integration g exists, if integration a to b f dx and integration a to b g dx both exist and f is monotone. See, whenever we are saying monotone, there are two possibilities, monotonically increasing or decreasing. Monotone on closed interval AB, then prove that there exists again a number zeta in closed interval AB such that, what is such that? Integration A to B of g dx is equal to f of a into integration a to zeta g of x dx plus f of b integration zeta to b g of x dx. See, this is about integration of product of two functions where both the functions are integrable. Both exist means both are bounded and integrable, and we want to prove the existence of a number zeta in this closed interval AB such that this condition is going to hold. Now, in order to prove this, we are going to make use of Bonnet's theorem. Actually, in the condition of Bonnet's theorem and Abel's lemma both, we have imposed with a function to be monotonically decreasing. But here it was a restriction that the function is monotone simply. Means there are both the possibilities. It may be either increasing or decreasing. Therefore, we will discuss the proof in two different cases. In the first case, we will discuss the function is monotonically decreasing. Case 1, I will write. Let f be monotonically decreasing, right? Because it was required in the statement. Now, similarly, we are going to prove the result for monotonically increasing as well. Okay. Now, what we are going to do, we are going to construct a function phi with the help of this f so that one can use the Bonnet's theorem to prove the required result. Therefore, now I am going to define, let the function phi I am going to define as f minus f of b. See what I am going to do? F minus f of b. F we have assumed monotonically decreasing. What about f of b? See, whenever I am saying f is monotonically decreasing, therefore for the different for these values, let me write here itself. Suppose we have made the partition of the given interval as say a, na? We are writing a less than or equals. A is nothing but x naught. X naught less than or equals to x1 less than or equals to x2, so on. Continue this up to xn is equal to b. Now, whenever f is monotonically decreasing, what should be the relation between their function values? What about f of a, f of x1, f of x2? What should be a relation between these values?
Less than equal.
Sure?
Yes, ma'am.
If it is less than or equals to, f of x1 will be greater equal by f of a, no? Means the value is increased. Are you getting? Suppose these are the points I have plotted, x1, x2, dot, 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 up to xn is equal to b. This is f of a, okay, whatever is the function I'm going to. Value at f of a, value at a, and value at x1. If the value of function at x1 is greater equal by the value of a, means somewhere is the position, na? And again, if f of x2 is greater by f of x1, again, this is the possibility. And so on, the value is getting increased. Therefore, as you go on, increase the interval values, the function values are also increasing. But what kind of function it will be then?
Monotonically increasing.
Therefore, what should be a relation here?
Greater.
Yes, it is greater equal. Is everyone getting me?
Yes, ma'am.
The values, what should be the positions? Instead of like this, let me rub this part. Okay, instead of like this, what we want, suppose somewhere here is my f of a. F of x1 is less than or equals to f of a, right? Like this. What about f of x2? F of x2 is less than or equals to f of x1 and continue. Somewhere here it is f of b. Therefore, what about the values? The values goes on decreasing. As you increase the values of x, the values of f goes on decreasing. Therefore, the function is monotonically decreasing in this case, right? Therefore, looking at this structure, may I say f of b is the smallest value among all the function values? F of b is,
yes, ma'am,
smallest among all the function values. Now, we are defining a new function phi which where in which we are going to subtract f of b from the remaining. Therefore, what will be the nature of 5? Will it be monotonically decreasing or not? Some fixed value we are subtracting from memory, every value. Okay, suppose this f of b is the value, f of a is 10. Okay, f of a is 10, say here it is say 7, here it is say 5. And suppose somewhere here at f of b we have a value 1. Right, here it is 1. Now what I am going to do, I am going to subtract this f of b equal to 1 from all the function values. What we were doing exactly then, what we were doing, we were just shifting this function value by 1 to the lower side. This 10 becomes 9, 7 becomes 6, 5 becomes 4, and 1 becomes 0. Right? Then what is the nature again? Is the nature remains same, monotonically decreasing?
Yes.
Okay. And f of b is the smallest value among all the function values. Therefore, what about f of a minus f of b, or any function value minus f of b? Will it be still non-negative, or rather positive, I will call. Right? Therefore, here I will write the function f minus f of b is positive and monotonically decreasing. Is it okay to everyone, or if you have any doubts, you can ask. Okay, therefore the new function 5 we have defined is f minus fb, and is positive and is monotonically decreasing as well. Now we are ready to use the Bonnet's theorem. What is Bonnet's theorem? Here I will write then by Bonnet's theorem. What is the statement of Bonnet's theorem? I'll write it in a bracket, right? Integration a to b phi g dx is equals to what we have written this to be? Phi of a integration a to zeta g dx. This we have proved already. Now, the stage is to use. Now, I'm going to put this value phi as f minus fb. G will be as it is. Correct? Now, what about f minus fb? This phi, is it integrable or not? What it is given? Integration f exists. Means f is bounded and integrable. Now, we were defining new function phi, f minus fb. Whether this phi will be bounded or not? Knowing f is bounded and we are going to subtract a fixed value, whether the function phi is bounded or not?
Yes, ma'am, it is bounded.
Yes, it is bounded. What about integrability?
It is integrable.
See,
also.
Here, yes, it is integrable. Why? Because this is the difference of two integrable functions. F is already given to be integrable, and f of b is constant, and we know constant is always an integrable function. And for this phi, whatever we have written is an integrable function. Therefore, knowing here one can put this value. Here only I can write f is positive, monotonically decreasing, and integrable. Is it okay? And integrable, because this is the difference of two integrable functions. Now we are going to just put up the value of phi as f minus fb, and we will do the calculations. Phi, I am going to substitute f minus f of b, g as it is, g dx I am keeping as it is. What about phi of a? Phi is f minus fb, means phi f of a. What about phi of x? This is f of x minus f of b. What about phi of a then? Is it f of a minus f of b?
Yes, ma'am.
F of a minus f of b. And the second integration a to g zeta g dx is as it is. Integration a to zeta g dx is as it is. Now what we will do? We will try to simplify. We will multiply by g and we will separate the integrations as it. So what will be the next line? This is the product f dot a g dx. Let me separate the integrations a to b f of b into g dx. Okay. Here multiply by f of a to the integration and we will separate. देखो दिस इज एफ ऑफ ए इंटीग्रेशन ए टू जीटा जी डी एक्स माइनस एफ ऑफ बी ए टू जीटा जी डी एक्स. Now here also in the second integration f of b is a constant that we can take it out, that we can take it out and we will shift this quantity on the right simultaneously. Therefore what will be the next statement? Integration a to b f g dx is equal to, first let me write the coefficient of f of a. Coefficient of f of a is f of a integration a to zeta g dx. Now this term I'm going to shift to the right, taking fb out. So this negative becomes positive. This is f of b integration a to b g dx minus this last term as it is f of b integration a to zeta g dx. Now just have a look to the two last two integrations. We will take f of b common and just have a look what we remains with. Let me take f of b common and v remains with integration a to b g dx minus integration a to zeta g dx. So what about this integration value? A to integration a to b minus integration a to zeta.
Zero.
How it is zero? From a to b we are subtracting a to zeta. Suppose this is a g curve and this is about a to b integration between a to b, somewhere here is zeta. Now first integration tells me integration over closed interval a to b means this whole region, correct na? And I'm going to subtract integration a to zeta from this. So for here let me mark integration a to zeta and I want to subtract this much region. Then what v remains with? Is it the remaining area integration from
zeta
to b?
To b. Yes ma'am.
Good. This is zeta to b g dx. And hence it is the proof. This is what we want to prove now. Integration a to b f g dx is f of a to zeta g f of b zeta to b. This is what we have proved. Correct? Hence the proof. But this is the proof we have given in the first case, considering f is monotonically decreasing. Now what we will do, we will discuss the case 2, let f is monotonically increasing, right? F is monotonically increasing. The result we have proved for monotonically decreasing. Now we want to claim this for monotonically increasing. But if f is monotonically increasing, what is the nature of minus f? Will it remains the same or whether the nature changes? Yes, students. If f is monotonically increasing, what about minus f? Whether it remains monotonically increasing or whether the nature changes?
It remains
no
the same,
minus.
Ma'am.
Remains the same. Sure. Everyone thinking the same? Just have a look. What is monotony increasing nature we have seen? As the values of x goes on increasing, the function value should also go on increasing. Like this, na? Right. As x increases, f also increases. What will happen if I take minus f? What will be the sketch here? It's the reflection we want to consider, na? Minus f means. What about the function? What about the straight line looks like? Is it of this shape?
Yes, ma'am.
Right. Then for what happens again? If I increase the values of x, what about the values of f? Whether it increases or decreases? Here it increases. Now it is going to decrease. Therefore, minus f will take a nature monotonically.
Decreasing.
Yes, monotonically decreasing. But for monotonically decreasing, already we have proved the result. That what we have to just do, we have to replace f by minus f in this above statement. Let me call this to be statement number one, say. Okay, here therefore I say, by using case 1, what I'm going to do? I'm going to replace f by minus f in equation number 1. But what is this equation number 1? This is a statement. Wherever f is present, I'm going to replace it by minus f. What will be the statement? Integration a to b minus f g dx is equal to minus f of a integration a to zeta g dx plus minus f of b integration zeta to b g dx. Wherever f is there, I have replaced the value by minus f. Minus f operated on a is minus f of a. Minus f operated on b is also minus f of a. If you look at the statement, what we were going to do? We will just multiply this equation by minus 1. Or cancelling minus 1, you can write. Multiplying by minus 1, we get, you have to cancel that negative throughout, right? For the multiplying by this, we have obtained the equation integration f g dx is equal to f of a integration a to zeta g dx plus f of b integration zeta to b g dx. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Whether any doubt about the second value theorem? If you have a doubt, you can ask. Otherwise, we will move towards the unit number 2 in today's lecture. Okay? This is just by use of Bonnet's theorem. One thing you have to remember is only we have to define a function phi as f minus fb, assuming f is monotonically decreasing, and just put the value in the Bonnet's theorem. If you put the values in the Bonnet's theorem, the proof will be automatically true. Okay, let us move towards the next unit. Now, in the next unit, heading is Riemann-Stieltjes integration. Check whether the screen is visible. Let me just stop the screen and I'll share once again. Is the new screen visible? Unit number 2, Riemann-Stieltjes integration.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, first unit we have seen is about Riemann integration. In this Riemann integration, we have found the value of an integration by the arithmetic process, and we have seen in detail how this integration helps us to give the area bounded by the curve with x-axis. Why we were saying the area is bounded with x-axis? Because the integration was taken with a variable x. Integration f of x dx we have written now. Therefore, whatever is the area is bounded with the x-axis. Therefore, this is a plane region where the area we can show and all. But in later higher studies, we have seen, after 12th standard, we have studied the how to take an integration of a function with respect to another function. And that was introduced by the pair of mathematician Riemann and Stieltjes, and that's why the heading is Riemann-Stieltjes integration. In this unit, we are going to study the integration of a given function f of x with respect to another function alpha of x, and this is called as Riemann-Stieltjes integration. Definition, upper sum, lower sum, condition of integrability goes very parallel to the concepts of Riemann integration, the only challenge is to understand the geometrical interpretation of Riemann-Stieltjes integration. First, let me write the definition and existence of the integration, and then we will move towards the geometrical interpretation of this Riemann-Stieltjes integration. Therefore, the definition, in order to define Riemann-Stieltjes integration, there should be two functions under the integration. Second function is alpha. We need both the functions to be bounded, and one more condition we will impose on that alpha function, that it is monotonically increasing function. Okay, let me write. Let f and alpha be bounded functions, on closed interval AB, and alpha be monotonic increasing function on closed interval AB, right? Now we will define the partition, comma, corresponding to any partition P. How I am going to define P? As usual, A is equal to x naught, x1 till xn is equal to b, we write. Now we will define the two sums. Or before that, I will define what is delta alpha. We write delta alpha I is equal to delta xi is the symbol we have used in order to give the length of the ith subinterval. Now we were using this to be to give the difference between the alpha values in the ith subinterval, and this is alpha xi minus alpha xi minus 1, and this is for I is equals to 1 to n up to n. Okay, then can anyone tell me the nature of delta alpha I, whether it is non-negative or non-positive? What should I write here? Greater equal or less equal by 0? Function is monotonically increasing, and we were defining alpha xi minus alpha xi minus 1. What about delta alpha?
Non-negative.
Non-negative or non-positive? Yes, it is not negative because the function is increasing. Therefore, alpha xi is greater equal by alpha xi minus 1. Now we will define the two sums. Which two terms we were going to define? Upper sum and lower sum. Define two sums. First is upper sum. For sum we were going to define, and let us check how we are going to denote it. Here U stands for upper sum, okay, with respect to a partition P of a function F. But here we were taking the upper sum with respect to another function alpha. Therefore, we were writing this as UP of alpha, and it is defined to be summation I equals to 1 to n capital MI into delta alpha I. What we have defined from Riemann integration? UPF is equals to, yes?
Summation
MI delta xi. Good. Summation I capital MI into
delta xi.
Here we have written delta alpha I, because the aim is to get the integration of a function here with respect to function alpha. In the Riemann integration, we have taken the integration with respect to x-axis, no? With respect to x-axis means the curve is the region between the area bounded by the curve. We have taken the region between curve and x-axis. Now we were taking with respect to the another function alpha. So that delta xi is being replaced by delta alpha I. Similarly, let me define lower sum. Yes, can anyone tell me what is lower sum? This is LPF alpha. With respect to alpha is the one more point is added simply.
Summation small
what
m
will
I
be
delta
definition?
alpha.
Yes. Summation small m I into delta alpha I. What about capital M I and small m I? Where? Capital M I and small m I are suprema and infima. Oh, sorry, small m I have to write. Small m I are suprema and infima of F in I a sub interval, right now? I the sub interval respectively. Is that okay to everyone? Both the sums, the only change is made as instead of delta xi, it was delta alpha I. And the reason behind taking the monotonically increasing function is in the Riemann integration, we are taking this with respect to x. And as we go on the right of x axis, the values are increasing. That's why we want the nature of the function to be monotonically increasing. Monotonically increasing. Is that clear to everyone? Then what do you think? What will be the two definitions of upper integral and lower integral? Before that, let me just write one inequality, right? What is the inequality? If small m and capital M are respectively the infima and the suprema of F in whole interval A to B, then we have, what we have? In order to prove the integrals, we want the integrals exist within suprema infima. Therefore, let me just prove this inequality. M less than or equals to MI less than or equals to capital MI less than or equals to capital M. This inequality, now we are familiar with this. Now let me multiply by delta alpha I. So what will be the inequality? M delta alpha I less than or equals to, or should I take both the steps simultaneously? Multiply. Now what is the next step? Taking the sum over I. Putting I equals to 1, 2, n and adding. And adding, what we will get? What will be the addition here? M delta alpha I from I equals to 1 to n. This is summation. M delta alpha I less than or equal. No doubt I is from 1 to n. Less than or equals to summation. Small m I delta alpha I less than or equals to summation. Capital M I delta alpha I less than or equals to summation. Capital M into delta alpha I is equals to 1 to n in every summation. If I put the value of I is equals to 1 here, okay, what will be the value? M is independent of I, let me take it out. But what about summation delta alpha I? This is summation, summation alpha xi minus alpha xi minus 1, right? No, delta alpha I we have defined. But if I put the value of I is equal to 1, this is alpha x1 minus alpha x0. Correct, na? For I equals to 1, the value is alpha x1 minus alpha x0. Alpha x0 is alpha a, I'll put it here. For I equals to 2, this is alpha x2 minus alpha x1. And continue, for I equals to n, this value is alpha x n, shall I write as alpha b? Alpha b minus alpha x n minus 1. This alpha x n will cancel with this. This alpha x 2 will cancel with the next and continue. This alpha x n will cancel with its previous. Therefore, we will remain with only two terms, alpha b and alpha a. Therefore, what is the value here? This first sum is small m times alpha b minus alpha a. What is this middle value? This is lower sum with respect to alpha, this is upper sum with respect to alpha. Therefore, again we have seen that both the sum values are bounded. Set of all upper sums, set of all lower sums is again bounded. And if the two values are bounded, one can define the intima and suprema of these two sets. So that one can define upper and lower integrals. Definition, upper and lower integral. Yes. You have to tell me the definition of an upper integral. Integration a to b bar. Upper integral I'm writing. F with respect to d alpha now. Yes. Similarly, we have to go for lower integral. Yes, students, what is upper integral?
Infimum of u, p, f.
What is upper? Good, this is infimum of the set in which we are considering u, p, f, alpha, and where p is partition of closed interval AB. And why the infima exists? Because just now we approved set of all upper sum is bounded between small m times alpha b minus alpha a to capital M times alpha b minus a. Similarly, set of all lower sum is also bounded. Okay. Therefore, what is the lower integral?
Supremum of LP
of
LP F alpha.
Good. Supremum of L P alpha, where P is partition of the closed interval. Okay. Now, what is the condition of integrability? Definition of integrability. Here I will just write the infima and suprema being taken over all partitions of closed interval AB. Okay, and these are called as upper and lower integral, upper and lower integral of F with respect to alpha, right? Because here I have written dx again. This is F d alpha. Okay. Now we will go for understanding what is definition of integrability. Yes, can anyone guess again?
Upper and lower integral must be equal.
Yes, upper and lower integrals are equal. Different, right? The function f is said to be integrable with respect to alpha if, what if? Integration a to b upper bar f d alpha is equal to integration a to b lower integral f d alpha. And we write whenever we say that the function is Riemann integrable rather Riemann Stieltjes integration integrable, we will write f belongs to R alpha of closed interval a b, or f belongs to R of alpha. Here R doesn't mean real number, it means it is Riemann integration. This is what we have seen, the definition of upper sum and lower sum, upper integral and lower integral. Now we have to understand what is the geometric interpretation. Now let me make you one thing clear, the geometric interpretation of Riemann-Stieltjes integration is nowhere given in any book of analysis. But it was published as one of the research paper. I'll just show you the research paper. Is there any difficulty with the definition? As we have done in Riemann integration, same we were doing in Riemann Stieltjes. Okay. So let me stop the screen. I'll share you the geometrical interpretation. It is being presented or it is being published as a research paper in the journal, the famous journal. Check, is the screen visible again?
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
We are changing the screen. Okay, see, this was a paper, a geometric interpretation of Riemann-Stieltjes integration, published in the journal Mathematical Association of America. Mathematical Association of America, and the proof was, or the interpretation was given by a mathematician, Gregory Bullock. And this was taken from American Mathematical Society. This was a monthly journal published in May 1988. This was published in May 1988. If you just search it on the Google, you will get this PDF, right? From this part started. This is the previous paper actually. From this we are going to study. We are going to just have a look on the geometrical interpretation. How the integration of f is calculated with respect to another function. This we have done many a times in our BSc level as well, right? So for here it was given with the definition. Closed interval AB be the given interval. We will define the partition of AB to x0 to xn. Same delta alpha k written. We have written alpha I, don't mind. This is alpha xk minus 1. Then capital MK, we are defining maximum, that is suprema. MK is minimum, that is infima. And UP of alpha is defined as summation mk delta alpha k. UP of alpha is defined as summation small mk delta alpha k. Okay. And here is I is the unique number we are writing between the two inequalities. And the symbol we were using is either integration a to b f d alpha or integration a to b f of x d alpha x. And it was a theorem proved that assume alpha increases monotonically, alpha dash is in Riemann integrable, then Riemann integration f with respect to alpha is defined as integration a to b f d alpha is integration a to b d alpha, we are writing alpha dash x into dx. Alpha dash x into dx, this was the theorem proved, right? Now by using this, we can solve the example. Let us have a look in 3D. Before going to the direct integration, we will just try to have a look on the functions, how it would look like, right? This is the function f of x in two-dimensional, right? This is f of x taken in a two-dimensional space. Okay, now if the same function I want to take in 3D, how it is going to look like? For example, suppose there is a straight line y equal to x in two dimensional space. If I take the same equation y equal to x in three dimensional spaces, how it is going to look like? Can anyone answer? What will be the nature of a line in three dimensional space? Whether y equal to x takes the same line in 3D? A single linear equation in two variables represents a plane in three-dimensional space. Correct, no? Let me just write here. See what I'm saying? Y equal to x is the equation of a line in two-dimensional space. But we know the equation of a plane in 3D is ax plus by plus z is equal to d. Therefore, here this equation is of this type. Now, I can write it as x minus y is equal to 0. Therefore, this is going to represent a plane in 3D. Okay. If a line in 2D will become a plane in 3D. On the parallel, this curve f of x in two-dimensional plane, if I take it in the 3D space, it will look like a surface. It will look like a surface. Is there any issue with this? Now, what is the third parameter we have taken? This is alpha. Okay. Similarly, this is alpha x is our another function. If you look at the curve, this function is monotonically increasing. This function is monotonically increasing looking at this curve. Again, if I want to plot this curve in 3D, it will become a surface. Now we have three variables with us. First is x variable. F and alpha both are dependent on x. F function and alpha function are dependent on x. Therefore, we can combine these three curves in a three-dimensional space as, okay, see, this is my three-dimensional space. This is x function, x axis. This is F axis. This is alpha axis. This is a three-dimensional space I'm going to consider. And whatever is this line we have seen, whatever is the curve, let me draw the curve again. This is the curve, no? F. Right? This is going to look like this surface in a three-dimensional space. This is going to look like a three-dimensional space. Therefore, this is just like a folded paper as a surface in a 3D space. The same I am going to write for alpha. What about alpha then? A separate sketch is not given or given up. Okay. I'll show you the separate sketch as well for alpha. Okay, this is the sketch. Now let us try check how it is going to look like in 3D. This is alpha, F and X. Okay, how the curve was taken? Somewhat like this, no? Now if I want to plot it in a 3D, how it is going to like? It's like a surface, and I'll just try to draw here. This is a surface. Okay, this is like a surface, right? Now what is the job? This is F surface, this is alpha surface, this is alpha of x. Now we will take it both in the same plane, okay? This alpha and F, we'll take it in the same plane and it is going to look like this. This is just an intersection of two sheets, two surfaces. What about this sheet? This is alpha sheet. What about this sheet? This is F sheet. This is F sheet. And as we are taking together, now we will take the intersection. Now as it is intersection of F with respect to alpha, therefore we will find out the intersecting part of F by alpha. Intersecting part of F by alpha. And what will be the intersection? The intersection looks like this, na? The intersecting part, rather one can say the alpha sheet part intersected by F is of this type. Here it was shaded. Okay, this was intersection of both the sheets, and whatever is the shadow of this sheet on F alpha plane, this is alpha F plane. We were going to take the shadow of this plane or in F alpha. Why we were taking in F alpha plane? Whenever we were taking the integration of F with respect to X, we were taking the integration or area in XF plane, not in 2D plane. Now here also we were taking the integration of F in alpha, F with respect to alpha. Therefore, the integration or the area should be calculated in F alpha plane. Therefore, whatever is this intersection, let us take its shadow in F alpha plane. F alpha, alpha I have written by mistake. This is alpha F plane. Therefore, whatever is the shadow of this plane in F alpha and whatever will be the region will be the actual integration of F with respect to alpha. Means this pink region will be the integration of F with respect to alpha. This is the area. This is the area. If you have a doubt, you can ask me. Some students were entering now in the Google class. What they were doing till now? The class is about to finish. Okay. If the students were having the questions, you can ask me. Okay, now this was an example given by taking alpha x is equal to x. by taking alpha x is equal to x. Alpha x is equal to x means what kind of line it will be? This is alpha and x. Alpha x is equal to x will be a straight line. Okay. Therefore, if I draw this in a 3D plane, what kind of sketch it will be? This is alpha, f, and x. Therefore, this is just a plane. This will be a plane. Right. Now, here, this is a f sheet. And this is alpha sheet, which is actually a plane. Why it's a plane? Because the function we have taken, alpha x is equals to x. Now, we were intersecting by this plane to this surface. The area below this will be actually a region, this region. And whatever is this shadow on in f alpha plane will be the actual integration. There were some 2-3 example was discussed by taking some simple cases. Suppose f of x is a linear function, straight line, and alpha and x is this curve, monotonically increasing of this type and this type. What, how it is going to look like then? What about f sheet? F sheet will become a plane in 3D. It's a plane. This is my f sheet. Okay. And as the nature of alpha 1x, we are considering like this. See, here it is the nature. Therefore, what will be alpha sheet? Alpha sheet will be a plane, just given with a curved nature, right? Then what is the intersection? Intersection by this curved sheet to this plane sheet will be of this type. Correct, ma'am? This region, right? And what is its shadow? The shadow in F alpha sheet will be this, and this is what the actual integration is. This is integration of D alpha. If we just change the nature of our alpha curve to this type, like this. Okay, only the shape changes. So this is my alpha sheet. This is a F sheet, which is a plane actually. F sheet is my plane. Okay. Then the intersection is like this. This is called as a fence, compound wall. And its a shadow will give us the integration. This is the integration f d alpha. This is the integration f d alpha. We are not bothering about the next one. This is just an integration part. This was not available in any mathematics textbook. Therefore, this was a research paper I want to discuss with you. If you have the difficulty in the geometrical aspect, you can ask me. Concept goes very similar to integration fx, correct? Why? Because in integration fx, what we have done? You have taken the integration of? Here, I will show you. This is here, integration with respect to x. Therefore, we have seen what is the area bounded between the two. Now, here also we want to show what is the area bounded between f and alpha. And that should be taken on f alpha plane. Here, as if we are taking on a 2D plane, fx plane. It is also called as fx plane. No? But x plane. Here, we want this integration to be in f alpha plane. This is f sheet, alpha sheet was discussed. And these are the intersection of the two sheets. Whatever is the region, we have to take the shadow in F alpha because we want the integration in F alpha plane. And that's all. And whenever alpha x is equal to x, it becomes the actual integration with respect to x axis. Correct, na? Whenever I'm writing F d alpha x and I'm putting F is equal to x, then this is F dx. Therefore, this was an integration. This integration is exactly similar to integration F dx. Because alpha x is equal to x was the curve taken. I hope the idea was understood to all the students. If you have the difficulty, you can ask me. From student side, is the voice audible or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
And this integration was actually developed by the pair of mathematicians, Riemann and Stieltjes. The full name of Stieltjes is Thomas Jonas Stieltjes. Let me show you the screen. Is the screen visible? No, I think. Screen visible on Wikipedia? Check students, whether the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
He was a mathematician, Thomas Jonas Stilges, born on 29 December 1856 to 31 December 1894. And he was a Dutch mathematician. And his pioneer work is in the field of moment problems, contribution to the study of continued fraction. Okay. And he was famous for Riemann-Stieltjes integration. Was of some information, it's a biography, Dutch mathematician, okay? He was the mathematician Thomas Jonas Stieltjes, worked with Riemann, and they together have developed a new integration, Riemann-Stieltjes integration, which was giving us the integration of a function f with respect to another monotonically increasing function, that is alpha. And just now we have discussed the geometrical interpretation as well. Actually, this was just a generalization of Riemann integration. Okay, but there is one more drawback in this integration theory, that we cannot take this integration on any set. We are taking the integration on a closed interval only. Okay, and that this part was given by a new mathematician called as Lebesgue, and the new integration is defined to be Lebesgue integration that we were going to study in the next semester under the heading of Real Analysis 2, Lebesgue integration. Okay? Yes, if you have a difficulty, you can ask me. I hope everything I have made very clear about Riemann-Stieltjes integration. In the next lecture, we will go for deriving some important deductions from Riemann-Stieltjes integration. One or two theorems, which are very similar to the theorems of Riemann integration. Then we will move towards the third topic of multivariable differential calculus. Thank you for being with me for this lecture. Thank you.